How long will Norfolk Southern maintain a presence in East Palestine?
As long as it takes. Yeah, we're going to see this thing through. That's my commitment to the community of East Palestine.
I wonder who's going to be the one who decides how long it takes in as long as it takes. I suspect him and his board. That's the CEO of Norfolk Southern, Alan Shaw. Of course, they're the company who became famous recently for causing one of the worst environmental disasters in modern American history in East Palestine. Many of the people there to this day, every day, complaining about eyes stinging, headaches, a number of different symptoms. But we keep being told by the company who has a vested interest in you not believing that, that everything's fine. And they've tested the air and they've tested the water and they've tested the soil. Who are you going to believe? The guy whose stock portfolio relies on this, or the actual people there? I don't know. I don't have any sort of direct conduit to the truth. I just have suspicions based on my life. In any event, he did actually deign to speak with PBS NewsHour, so that's good. And here's a little bit more about the financial commitment that they have to the people who've been affected.
And that's a down payment. And we're gonna invest in this community for the long haul to help this community recover and help this community thrive.
When you say the $6.5 million is a down payment, as you know, the average income for an East Palestine family is less than $45,000 a year. We've talked to people who say they need Norfolk Southern to pay their medical expenses, to pay their moving expenses, and to pay for independent testing of wells and soil and air. Is that something that you would commit to?
We've stood up a lot of testing within an hour of the derailment. We had air testing. Within a couple hours of the derailment, we've had water testing. There is independent testing going on right now with the Ohio EPA and with local health officials.
Did you notice what happened there? I noticed what happened there. He was asked a question and he answered a similar question, but not the question, because he started talking about the testing. And I'll grant you, PBS NewsHour guy did mention testing, but he also mentioned something like a financial commitment to paying all of those things. And weirdly, the CEO of Norfolk Southern forgot about that part and just talked about the testing they're doing. Oopsie, I'm sure he'll return to it because they do feel a deep and abiding financial commitment to the well-being of the people of East Palestine going forward.
You're noticing how a lot of people are complaining and talking about Democrats, the Biden administration. They're lying to us about the air and the water and everything there. But previous to that, when people are complaining about air and water issues, specifically around minority communities, I think it was maybe specifically some Fox News hosts were talking about how, well, I can't believe you guys are complaining about these things. We care about air and water, and they gave no examples of it. But in this particular case, they can use this politically. So of course, they're using it politically. If using it politically, that means you have to only attack the other side. Have you heard any of these conservative politicians or any of these pundits talking about the rail company and this CEO, first off, dodging the citizens, those white citizens that they explicitly point out? Now that it's coming for white folks, it's this government is going to ignore them. I think it was Charlie Kirk that said that, maybe even Tucker Carlson.
So basically all of them.
So when the CEO doesn't show up and gives these white citizens the middle finger, do you start coming after the CEO? Do you point out that they paid off politicians to under-regulate them so that accidents like this are more likely to happen? And then when they do happen, they don't show up and they toss maybe $1,000 at people and say, isn't that good enough for you? You guys are poor folks. Doesn't that work out for you? Have you come after the rail companies yet? The reasons that they haven't is because if people start looking into that and then other people look further, they'll understand that this is all coordinated with politicians that have been bought off. And then when they get mad about that, they might say, hey, maybe we shouldn't allow corporations to buy off politicians. Then the whole house of cards falls down, because even their supporters will realize the people that say they support and represent them are effing liars.
It's amazing. Like if you're a conservative that is watching this right now, which you probably aren't, but if you are, and you've liked all of the, like, they're doing a race war on the white people with this, isn't it weird that all those people, Charlie Kirk and Tucker Carlson, all of them, don't care at all about the company that did the race war, supposedly? No, it's all in the EPA. You know, the people who did not own the company, the train, anything like that. Isn't that weird? It's almost as if this is a convenient aside, an attack against the Biden administration while allowing the same sort of conditions to continue. And if that means more train derailments, whatever. Like, but really, incentives wise, why wouldn't they want that? If that happens again, then they can do the race war thing again. Like, why would they want the derailments to stop if stopping them meant that corporations would temporarily have to invest in more safety measures? Why would they actually want that? Anyway, I do want to let you know, though, you know, regardless of this massive attempt at PR that we're seeing right now, the EPA is saying that they're taking over, and the full EPA, not, you'll notice, the Ohio EPA that he keeps talking about. And they all are also saying that the cleanup will be financially put on the shoulders of Norfolk Southern, which is good. And weird that it's necessary. Weird that they would have to order Norfolk Southern to do that, considering how devoted to the people Norfolk Southern is. In any event, is one of the topic we need to get to, and it has to do with lobbying against safety rules that Norfolk Southern and other train companies have done historically. Let's take a look at that.
A question about rail safety, because in November and December, Norfolk Southern met with federal regulators and pushed back against this proposed rule that would have, in most cases, mandated at least two crew members on trains. Why did Norfolk Southern spend so much money, millions upon millions of dollars, lobbying against it?
What we're really interested in is solution-based safety rules. And we're very focused on following the science. And with respect to this accident, the National Transportation Safety Board, as you know, they're in charge of this investigation. And I'm very much looking forward to their results of their investigation. Once we have that, we're going to sit down and we're going to figure out, you know, what we could have done better.
Man, that guy's like shockingly bad at this. Why did you dispatch him to do this? Was there no one else? Maybe there isn't anyone else. If they think that two people is too many for a train, maybe two executives is too much for a company. Maybe he is literally the only person in management. I just love his, I just want solutions based. I'm really excited for the results, because when the results come, presumably this conversation will be over. Okay. I guess I feel like we're asking you important questions, buddy, about you spending millions of dollars to save a little bit of money in salary and benefits to just a second person on a mile and a half long train. You think that's excessive? Is that not following the science? But please, please, Alan Shaw, do more of these interviews. I am begging of you.
Well, they know the good news for him is he did it on PBS, where people who would
I know.
I believe all the BS we'll never watch.
That's true. I'll take the wind out of my sails, Jayar Jackson. Get this guy on. You know what? Can we get him on our show, actually? I want to talk to him.
Imagine anyway. The questions if he goes on Fox News. Let's just imagine.
Oh, God, no. Like, is Michael S. Regan devoted to poisoning every white boy?
Check out the Damage Report podcast each day, wherever you get your podcasts, whether Pocket Casts or Stitcher or iTunes. You can join me as I give you the news and stories you want, with a range of co-hosts and interview guests jumping in on the fun each day. Again, that's the Damage Report, wherever you get your podcasts. And if you get them at iTunes, don't forget to rate and review. Sometimes I'll read them live on the show.